3 John, 15 verses. Beginning in verse 1. The elder to the beloved Gaius, whom I love in the truth. Beloved, I pray that all may go well with you and that you may be in good health as it goes well with your soul. For I rejoice greatly when the brothers came and testified to your truth, as indeed you are walking in the truth. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. Verse 5, beloved, it is a faithful thing you do in all your efforts for these brothers, strangers as they are, who testified to your love before the church. You would do well to send them on their journey in a manner worthy of God. For they have gone out for the sake of the name, accepting nothing from the Gentiles. Therefore, we ought to support people like these, that we may be fellow workers for the truth. I have written something to the church, but Diotrephes, who likes to put himself first, does not acknowledge our authority. So if I come, I will bring up what he is doing, talking wicked nonsense against us. And not content with that, he refuses to welcome the brothers and also stops those who want to and puts them out of the church. Beloved, do not imitate evil, but imitate good. Whoever does good is from God. Whoever does evil has not seen God. Demetrius has received a good testimony from everyone and from the truth itself. We also add our testimony, and you know that our testimony is true. I had much to write to you, but I would rather not write with pen and ink. And I hope to see you soon, and we will talk face to face. Peace be to you. The friends greet you. Greet the friends, every one of them. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Father, that even now, just to vocalize your word, that's automatically your Holy Spirit speaking to us. Lord, we want to receive that, knowing that the word never returns void. Lord Jesus, we thank you, God, that we have the privilege, the freedom to be able to sit down and be with one another in fellowship without fear of condemnation, without fear of persecution, and with the ability to expound together what the Holy Spirit wants to say to us. So Lord Jesus, as a personal account, Lord God, I ask that you would fill me, you would anoint me, Holy Spirit, to be able to preach the words that you want me to preach. Lord, I truly desire to decrease in order that you might increase. Lord, this church desires to decrease in order that you might increase, Lord Jesus. We desire for you to restore our souls. Give us the food that we so desperately need, the bread of life, the living water, so that we never go spiritually hungry again, that we never thirst spiritually again, entering into an eternity where we feast with you. Lord God, we thank you for tonight. We ask that you would bless it. Holy Spirit, fall afresh on us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. It's a little bit nostalgic, I guess. It's not nostalgic. It's a little bit sad for me to finish this series. It's been such a privilege for me to be able to do this. We started this series a little bit halfway into 1 John chapter 2, I believe, when we first came back from Bristol. And it's just been such a privilege for me to be able to preach this to you. We remember that when we see 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, we can look at them as a whole, as epistles from John writing to the churches. And we saw in 1 John that he wrote to a network of churches in Asia Minor, what we consider to be modern-day Turkey. And then what we discovered in 2 John is that he wasn't writing necessarily to an entire network of churches, although that letter did spread, but it was intended initially for one specific church. And now here we have the privilege, we have the pleasure to enter into 3 John, where now John pays special attention to a congregant within the church. Last Wednesday, we looked at 2 John together, and 2 John showed us how to be lovers of truth in a world that no longer cares about the truth. To be lovers of truth, even in the midst of those that would seek to distort the truth. And how to hospitably, calling it, we called that text hospitable truth last week, how to hospitably defend those that would distort the truth, seeking to infiltrate our churches and our homes. And so 3 John reestablishes this understanding, how to walk in the truth and how to engage with one another, especially those that are in the world, engage in love and truth together. But now in 3 John, he continues this understanding on a personal level. 3 John is one of a small portion of epistles where an apostle is writing directly to a person. The majority of the epistles or the letters of the New Testament focus on churches or networks of churches. But this one has a minority, a uniqueness about it amongst others, that it points to one person. And I want to excite you, I want to encourage you, for you guys to be motivated and excited to know that after next week, which is our worship Wednesday, we're going to be jumping into another personal epistle, an epistle of Paul writing to Philemon. Pastor Paul's going to have the pleasure of preaching that to you guys, and I'm really excited about that. Philemon is one of those epistles that truly defines and shows us how to apply and how to know what reconciliation is under a Holy Spirit work of God. So I hope you're excited about that. But what we're going to be looking at in 3 John together, what we will discover tonight is a re-engagement into the dialogue of truth and love, found in those who not merely know the truth, believers in Jesus Christ. We don't merely know the truth, do we? We also walk in it. We engage with it. We act upon it. We live it as being salt and light in a dark world. We remember from 2 John in verses 4 to 6 where it talks about that, where John writes to a church saying, "I rejoice greatly to find some of your children walking in the truth, just as we were commanded by the Father. And now I ask you, dear lady, not as though as we're writing to you a new commandment, but the one we've had from the beginning, that we love one another." Verse 6, here's the emphasis, "And this is love, that we walk according to his commandments. This is the commandment, just as you have heard from the beginning, so that you should walk in it." The emphatic word that John uses in 2 John and now re-engages with us here in 3 John is, how do we walk in the truth? How do we walk in a manner that proclaims the truth in both voice and action, but is completely and utterly surrounded and soaked in the compassionate love of Jesus Christ? How do we do that in obedience? Well, now John takes this on a personal level, this understanding, this teaching, and he wants to relate it to us in this way through 3 testimonies that we will discover here in 3 John. 3 testimonies from 3 different people that show us how to apply walking in obedient truth and obedient love in a dark world that so desperately needs to hear it. So he begins with this letter to the recipient, Gaius. That's our first testimony. Let's look at the very beginning in verses 1 and 2 together. Here's the introduction that he's writing to his friend Gaius. Verse 1, "The elder to the beloved Gaius, whom I love in truth. Beloved, I pray that all may go well with you and that you may be in good health as it goes well with your soul." The elder, who we confirmed last week as John, writes to this man, Gaius, whom he loves in the truth. I love that little introduction. He uses that in 2 John as well. I love the fact that he says, "I love you because of a reason. There's a reason why I love you. It's because of the truth. It's the truth that has both set us free as brethren in Christ. It's the truth that is made known to all the nations, as it's been proclaimed since the beginning of time." Ephesians says even before the foundations of the world, there's been this dynamic, wonderful truth that there's a God in heaven and he wants to have relationship with his creation. So much so that he would be willing to send his most valuable possession, his only son, to walk upon the earth and to die in order that we might have relationship with him. John writes here, "The reason that I love you, Gaius, is because of the truth that we share." Friends, this is how the church should live. We love one another because we share a powerful, I would say the most powerful, truth that we have ever received before. That of the salvation of Jesus Christ. And I like this, that there's many occasions in the New Testament where the name Gaius is used. Let's take a moment to look at this person, Gaius. Many occasions in the New Testament where the name Gaius is used, all positive, all encouraging to the name associated. However, you know, we can't really be positive that all of these names of Gaius is the same man. Gaius was a fairly common name in the Roman Empire at the time. But what we do know about this particular Gaius in 3 John is that he is loved by John. In this short letter, John calls Gaius beloved 4 times. Now we know that word in modern English just to understand, you know, yeah, beloved, you're loved by me. You call your wife, hey, there's my beloved. You call your children, these are all my beloveds. And it shows an intimacy in relationship of love. But we see in just these 15 verses, John uses Gaius as the name beloved in a way that stems farther than just their personal relationship together. This term beloved, as he's used in all 3 of his epistles before, is a common one used by John, but in the Greek it shows us a wonderful visual of our fellowship together and our fellowship under Christ. The Greek word for beloved, of course, is the word agapetos. We come from that wonderful love word in the Greek, the agape love that is unconditional, that is self-sacrificing, that is willing to go to the farthest depths in order that the consummation of that love might come to play. And this is what shows to us in agapetos, in knowing of the beloved. It shows us the joyful reality that this man is loved by the Apostle John in a beautiful way. But there's even more truer beauty than that. The true beauty understood here is that this man is first loved by Christ. This should be the dynamic in our relationships when we have a fellowship with one another, is to have that understanding that I love you not just because of who you are, but it's because of what Christ has done both in us and through us together. What knits us together is more, again, and I'm relating this back from when I taught 1 John, what knits us together as a church is more than just a common goal, a common vision, a common purpose, but the tangible reality of Christ-like love in relationships amongst all of us in our testimonies. All of us come from these different backgrounds. Backgrounds that if we were to meet in the world, we might have no common interest in starting a friendship, starting a relationship, but we're unified automatically when we come into a relationship of fellowship that is bound by the love of Jesus Christ. This is a joyful reality that can only be shown and understood in the church. John could not say, I love you with agape love to Gaius, unless Christ had not shown agape love to them first. John could not love Gaius with agape love if he had not first experienced agape love from Jesus himself. I cannot share with you agape love unless first Christ has shown agape love to me. And so here he's able to say, the elder to the beloved Gaius, whom I love in the truth, beloved, I pray that all may go well with you and that you may be in good health as it goes well with your soul. What's cool about this is that we realize this is a letter. This is communication between one person and another. Letters, I think, have gone slowly the way of the buffalo, as it were, now that email is just overwhelmed us with information, oftentimes information that we really don't even need. But here is a letter written with pen and ink on paper, given to one man to another. And if you notice in verse 2, to say that I pray that all may go well with you and that you may be in good health, that was a common introduction that people would write within the Roman Empire to say hello to a friend, a colleague, or a family member. It was just the kind thing to say. I hope you're doing well and that I hope that you're in good health. John writes this, but he adds a twist to it, as you notice there in verse 2. John adds to the fact that his health would prosper as well as, you see in verse 2, the health of his soul. Do you see that? I pray that all may go well with you and that you may be in good health as it goes well with your soul. John wants to illuminate something for us here that I think is important. He illuminates the understanding that our physical health often has a connection with our spiritual health. Oftentimes, when we're physically healthy, it's easier for us to have clarity of mind and the physical energy to seek the Lord and to make Him known. And there are other times that much of us have all felt before in our physical health when we've been ill and we don't have the energy or the mental clarity to be able to share the gospel with somebody. Even more, this just shines out to me as a pastor, the ministry of pastors and leaders who come and visit those in the hospital who are ill and who are sick. Because oftentimes, some of us are so sick that we can't even open the Word of God and be able to share in a wonderful fellowship with Christ our Lord because we're infirmed. It's such a blessing to be able to go and visit my grandmother, 92 years old as she is, where able to share scripture with her. Here's a ventilator in her mouth. She cannot speak the words, yet she worships God when hymns are being sung. I had the pleasure of as a pastor and as a grandson to be able to come into the hospital room before the ventilator came in and to share scripture with her. And we opened it up and I said, "Why don't I read Psalm 34 to you?" And she says, "Okay, that's fine." And wonderful grace and consciousness, and I start reading to it, and I end up reading one stanza, and before I can finish it, she finishes the verse for me. And then I go to the next verse, she finishes that verse for me. And it comes to be the point where I'm not reading it at all, and she's reciting Psalm 34 to me. And that's just a wonderful blessing to have a godly heritage as a side tangent. But even more, there's just this wonderful ministry of pastors being able to serve those who are sick and infirmed and are in the hospital. It's commanded to us by Scripture to do this. James chapter 5, verse 14, "Is any among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord." There is a connection of our physical health to our spiritual health. Our environment and where we are, it can either add or take away to the perspective and intimacy we have with our spiritual maker. I think of this in many categories. When we fast, what are we doing? We are physically removing ourselves from something that is normal in our life in order that we might be consecrated to prayer and have an intimacy with God that we wouldn't naturally and normally have. When you're on a retreat, when you go out into the woods, when we have a men's retreat, men coming in October, put a pen in it. You guys ready for that? When we go out and do a retreat, we're going out into the woods, into a forest, and we're in an environment where we're able to walk off, and we're in the creation that God has created, and we see all of the wonderful works, the trees and the hills, they clap their hands. The birds sing of His glory, and we find this intimacy. Where we physically are often has a consequence, an effect on where we are spiritually. Here's another connection before I stop this tangent, of course. Another connection of the physical and spiritual that I believe is very important for us to understand is our approach when we are being ministered by the Holy Spirit. A word that we don't often hear in the modern church today that I think is good for us to relate to again is the act of prostration before the Lord. You guys know what prostration is, right? It's when we physically get on our knees, we get on our faces to be in the presence of a holy God, to petition Him with our needs, to praise His name in our prayer closets. And when Christ calls us to pray, the physical environment of where we pray, it matters to Him. We know from Scripture that when Jesus was teaching the disciples to pray in Matthew chapter 6, verse 6, He was very intentional about showing them that there's not just the spiritual aspect of prayer, but there's also a physical aspect. He says this in Matthew chapter 6, verse 6. "When you pray, go into your room and shut the door. And pray your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you." Friends, I've found in my personal prayer life in Christ, where I am when I'm praying and what I'm doing while I'm praying, it matters a whole lot. It matters a whole lot to my spiritual life. praying in secret, prostrate before God. It aligns my physical body with the desires of my heart. Because so often, in my daily routine, in my daily life, and maybe friends, you can affirm this, you have so much of a desire to set time aside to pray, but there's the physical pull of demands and needs that you need to accomplish that tends to take you away from it. When's the last time that you've prostrated yourself before the Lord? You've turned your phone off. You've gone into your secret closet. You've gone into your bedroom. You've gone outside. You have some trail that you're able to walk on. You have a place where you can be alone before the living God. And all that is to occupy your mind, your eyes, your senses is what the Holy Spirit wants to do. I crave that. I hope you would too. And it matters. I encourage you, if you don't have that ability, if you don't have that place to make that place, find it. Get one, prostrate yourself before the living God, meditate on Him, and experience truly what the peace that passes all understanding really is all about. So enough of that. Verse 3, "For I rejoiced greatly when the brothers came and testified to your truth, as indeed you are walking in the truth." And verse 4, what a wonderful verse. "I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth." Notice something here that is expressed in a relationship between two brothers in Christ. Do you notice there? What's the emphatic word? The word there is joy, verses 3 and 4. Joy expressed in verse 3 and 4 is a communal experience. Do we see this? Gaius receives joy because he's walking in the truth. And John, what does he do? He receives joy because he's heard the testimony of Gaius. You see that? There's this communal relationship of joy being expressed between brothers in Christ. Gaius receives the result of joy. Why? Because he's obeying God. He's not fulfilling the lusts of the flesh. He's turning his eyes towards Christ, and the testimonies of his faithfulness are going to brothers and sisters around the community. And John hears this, and it causes his heart to leap for joy. Our greatest joy as a church is to see believers saved and walking in the truth. Truly, there is no greater excitement for me as a pastor is to see a man, a woman come to church, find saving faith in Jesus Christ, and their lives are changed, not because of what we offer, but what the Holy Spirit offers in them. Filling them up, changing them, consecrating them with spiritual gifts, showing them who God truly is in a relationship, how they've turned away from the past and look forward to what they can do for Christ in the future. Walking in the truth, what joy. Here we are in verse 4. Oftentimes verse 4 is used for the joy of seeing our physical children walk in the truth. I have this written and underlined in my Bible and also written in journals multiple times. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. Parents, isn't that the case as believers? Doesn't that play a role in how our church wants to come alongside you in the teaching of the Word of God to your children? How it takes more than just a coloring page to show them the gospel, but it takes an integral part of relationship and fellowship, sharing the Word of God and showing them what it means to be believers in Christ. There's nothing better, there's no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. Personally, as a pastor, that is always to be my first ministry. Fathers, mothers, that is your first ministry more than anything else, is to see your children being raised up in the truth. Before I can ever come up here and stand before you in a pulpit, I need to be sure that my family is walking in the truth. It says in Scripture, if they're not, then I need to take a step down. I need to go deal with my family. Consecrate them before the Lord. Have them walking in the truth. Because how can I work in a ministry if my family is in shatters? Just as grand, just as amazing is to see brethren walking in the truth in unity and joy as a fellowship of believers in Christ. So often it's hard to have a church when there's new believers because oftentimes there's that automatic battle of flesh versus the spirit. And we might be saved under Christ and we might be clothed in the fine linen of the saints, clothed in righteousness. And the punishment of sin is no longer upon our shoulders because it's been put upon Christ, but there's still the consequences of sin that often happen on our physical bodies. We might still have bondage to situations. We still might have damage because of iniquity and sin. And it's the church's role to be able to gather that flock together and have Jesus and the Holy Spirit minister to those people. But friends, it's so important as a church to be unified together and share that welcoming factor of saying, you're welcome to come in. You don't have to come in perfect with good clothes on and well-oiled shoes and the perfect set of hair. And you don't have to come in looking perfect with the perfect words, the perfect eloquence, the perfect mannerisms, knowing all the words to the hymns. No, a church is designed to have sinners come in and experience grace for the very first time, to be changed and continually changed. Friends, none of us have reached it yet. None of us have reached perfection. We will not reach it until we stand before the throne of God. But we are continuing in a walk of maturity together. And it's important for us to be able to help and pick up the weaker brother, pick up the weaker sister, and guide them in a direction with us. Come, run the race with me. It's a wonderful thing to hear that my children are walking in the truth, not just my physical children, but the children of the church. And now comes the admonition, comes the teaching, the caution, the wonderful work that John wants to share with Gaius, verses 5 through 8. Beloved, there it is again. It is a faithful thing you do in all your efforts for these brothers, strangers as they are, who testified to your love before the church. You do well to send them on their journey in a manner worthy of God, for they have gone out for the sake of the name, accepting nothing from the Gentiles. Therefore, we ought to support people like these that we may be fellow workers for the truth. What's wonderful is you can kind of see the trickle down of the letter here. He's welcoming Gaius and saying, oh, I'm so happy that you're in the truth. It's causing me great joy to hear your testimony, so much so that I want to share with you exactly what you've done in your testimony that gives me great joy. Isn't that wonderful? I mean, oftentimes when a parent wants to do that with a child, it's so embarrassing, right? When they're in the midst of family and friends at a picnic and, oh, Johnny, you got the honor roll today. And Johnny knows that. He doesn't want to share that with so many people. But the parents are so excited, they just want to share it with everybody. Here John is sharing with Gaius, oh, your testimony, it's giving me such joy. Let me tell you how. This is verses 5 through 8 and how it's shared with us. So John shares with us why Gaius' testimony is a good example. It was his hospitality to strangers that gave John great joy. To Gaius, loving these strangers, these pilgrims, or as I understand it to be shown here in the letter, as missionaries, it was a part of his practical outworking of the command to walk in the truth. Verse 5 is a statement that, you know, I covet about myself. Look at verse 5. Wouldn't that be a wonderful thing if you were known by that? It is a faithful thing you do in all your efforts for these brothers, strangers as they are. Can I paraphrase that? It's as if John is saying, whatever Gaius does, you can be sure that he will do it faithfully. I want to be known by that. Do you want to be known by that? Whatever this person does, you can be sure that he's going to do it faithfully. She's going to do it faithfully. She's going to do it as she would have done it if the living God was standing there in that room watching her do it. Every encounter, we can trust that through Gaius's hospitality, you will leave on your journey in a manner worthy of God. What is John saying here about Gaius's hospitality? Well, it's understood in the cultural context of the time that these strangers, they were preachers, they were missionaries, they were traveling pilgrims on their way to a field that was ripe with harvest. And they needed the support of fellow Christians along the way to provide housing, food, and financial support. And what we need to see here as an application for our church in the testimony of Gaius is this: we are called to support those who are called in other places. We are called as a church to support those that are called to go out and to plant churches, those that are called to go serve amongst others in foreign lands. And what we need to see as a church is that although we might not be missionaries in foreign places, we play an integral role in their ministry through hospitable support. I can affirm this as a previous missionary myself. Notice what it says here in verse 8. Therefore, we ought to support people like these. Here's the emphasis that I want you to look at, that we may be fellow workers for the truth. I truly believe that we as a church do a great job in supporting our missionaries, supporting those that we may not see on a day-to-day basis, maybe even on a yearly basis. I think we do a great job of that. Because I think what we have as a church and what needs to be reaffirmed here is that we as a church, it's very clear that we support through prayer and finances those who go off into ministry, knowing that we take part in that ministry even though we're not present with them. This is the wonderful thing, that the Holy Spirit works where we cannot be in the physical. This is the power of prayer. This is the power of gathering up finances and resources and sending them off to countries that we've never been, because the Holy Spirit works outside of mere physical location. It travels. He travels faster than any amount of transportation that we can understand or know in meeting the needs of missionaries, because we are fellow workers in that ministry. I can attest to this. Friends, there has been occasions where I've gone through seasons of hardship, seasons of toil, seasons of need, where I did not vocalize that request, only making it known to the Lord and having those requests be made known by fellows, brothers and sisters in this church. Why? Because they were praying for me. They were lifting me up. And they were sending those resources needed, even though they had never stepped foot in England or in Bristol. This is the work of the church, not just in the local community, but in the entire world. You take part in the world work of the Holy Spirit when you pray, when you're hospitable, and when you send those resources. What an example in Gaius that he would be faithful to that testimony. And this is what brings John great joy. And friends, it brings me great joy to know that we have wonderful examples. We have wonderful, if I can even say this, Gaiuses here within the church that seek to give in this way. We want to see more. We want to see more Gaiuses. So let me share with you now the second testimony. And now we need to move a little bit faster, verses 9 through 10. I've written something to the church, but Diotrephes, who likes to put himself first, does not acknowledge our authority. So if I come, I'll bring up what he is doing, talking wicked nonsense against us. And not content with that, he refuses to welcome the brothers and also stops those who would want to and puts them out of the church. Here's testimony number two of the three testimonies we're looking at tonight. The testimony of Diotrephes is fourfold. If you can see this here, this is what he's known for in Scripture since John has put his pen to paper. Number one, he does not acknowledge the authority of the apostles. He talks wicked nonsense, ultimately meaning gossiping. He's not welcoming to brothers in Christ. And even more than that, he stops those who want to be welcoming. He stops others from doing that ministry. John shares with us here a negative testimony, a negative example of what we are not to be as believers if we are walking in the truth. The disappointing understanding here is that Diotrephes is a believer, if you can believe that. He's a believer here in the church. Even alluding to understanding here, he's a man of authority within the apostolic church, the community of believers. And he is one who thinks he's on the side of righteousness. And here he is actually hindering the work of the ministry, hindering the work of the gospel. There's times when I was in Bristol when we were planting churches, and there's those who caught wind of us wanting to plant in a church, and there's feelings of threatenings of I don't know what it was we were incurring on their territory or something to that effect. And there's this rumor that started spreading around Bristol that we were this weird American cult that was followed by this American leader that you couldn't trust any of them. Here's believers in Jesus Christ sharing this with other believers in order that truly, I think, the hindrance of the gospel was made. Even so today, you can go on Google and search Calvary Bristol, and it's like the second or third one. It says Calvary Bristol is a cult. It's amazing to me. And I felt so much sorrow. I came to Hannah, and I remembered, I remember sitting down with her in the kitchen, and I said, you know what? I enjoy more being amongst atheists now than I do with believers, because at least with atheists, I know where I stand. I can have a conversation with them, and they know exactly where I'm from, I know exactly where they're from, and there's no weird backbiting that's going on, because I'm getting backbiting from the church. And it's such a negative example for us, not just to ourselves, but to the ultimate world, that we look at a person, and just because they do something somewhat differently than we do, but the gospel is clear, scripture is clear, that we would say, no, I don't want to have a part of that. And even more so, I don't want you to have a part of that. This is the negative example. Here is Diotrephes working not out of a sense of love, but a sense of pride. And here is John, who is known as the apostle of love, publicly rebuking a man for his sin in the hindrance of the gospel. Even to the point that 2,000 years later, this man's name will be associated with the negative. And John, in fact, here is working in accordance to love for the benefit of the church. And you know what, friends? He's rebuking this man publicly, not just for the benefit of the church, but even for the benefit of Diotrephes. That he might hear this letter and say, you know what, you're right. I see the example of Gaius, a congregant. And here I am, a man in a place of authority. I should be walking in the truth in an obedient way. This is why here in verse 11, John makes it so very clear. He says, beloved, do not imitate evil, but imitate good. Whoever does good is from God, and whoever does evil has not seen God. How did John do good with walking in the truth here? In these two examples of the testimonies, John showed love to both of these men. He did it in the joyfulness of the testimony of Gaius, and he did it in the exposure of sin to Diotrephes. Both of them were standing for the truth, walking in the truth, but doing it as a work of love. And friends, we see these examples every day because we are examples to one another. And there's always going to be that question that stands before us, especially when we're in our prayer closets, praying before the living God, having that communication with Him, is that call again. Quell your pride. Put on some meekness. And start living as an emulation, an example of my Son Jesus. John doesn't want to end this way. Here in verse 12, he receives with us one last testimony, and a testimony that I think is so powerful. Verse 12, Demetrius has received a good testimony from everyone and from the truth itself. We also add our testimony, and you know that our testimony is true. While Diotrephes' testimony was fourfold, Demetrius' is threefold. And friends, it is a sweet threefold. Let me share this with you. Do you see that there in verse 12? He's a good testimony from everyone, from the truth itself, and from the apostles. How amazing. One man has a good testimony from everyone that he knows, from Scripture itself, and from the apostles. I love this because we don't know anything about Demetrius, do we? Other than what this verse says. The only thing we know about this man Demetrius is that his testimony was good. That's all we know. Nothing more, nothing less. His testimony was good. And what's wonderful about this is here's a man in relative obscurity as it concerns the history of redemption shown here in the New Testament. But his obscurity cries out as worship to God. His name is not being made known. Christ's name is being known because of his testimony, not because of his name. The testimony of God's faithfulness is what shines in his life, even to the point that truth itself, scripture itself, cries out here in this epistle. Here is a man with a good testimony. That's all you need to know. Friends, what is important about the Christian life, what rings well when we walk in the truth, the desires of our hearts, it should be this, that our names would fade away in obscurity, but our testimony would remain. Count Zinzendorf, awesome name, awesome historical figure within church history. Count Zinzendorf, he's a bishop of the Moravian Church. His life motto was this: preach the gospel, die, and be forgotten. His testimony was greater than his own name, as awesome as his name was. Are we able to say that? As a church, that we, when people say, oh, what's your church like? Or you know what, I've heard about Calvary Chapel before. More so than the name of Calvary Chapel, more so than any of the names of the pastors or ministry leaders within this church, it's the desire of our hearts. I know it's the desire of the pastor's hearts, the leader's hearts, for us to understand this, that the name of Jesus is proclaimed more so than any accolade or success, certificate on the wall, whatever it is. We want Jesus' name to be known and our testimony to be sure. Verse 13 through 15, I'm sorry I have to rush through this. Verse 13 and 15, here's the conclusion. I had much to write to you, but I would rather not write with pen and ink. And I hope to see you soon and we will talk face to face. Peace be to you. The friends greet you. Greet the friends, everyone, every one of them. Here's an even wonderful testimony. Friends. Scripture saying believers with no names, just friends, but excellent testimonies. Who stood and walked in dynamic, engaging truth, and now whose testimonies have stood the test of time, even to today, 2,000 years later, all because of Jesus Christ. All because Christ has called you his beloved. He has shown his agapeo love towards you that we might show it to one another. So much so, changing who you are and changing your destiny, that you are no longer fully separated from God, but now you are closer than you can possibly become. That entering into eternity with him, entering into heaven with him, is the end result of your life. And that you are no longer enemies, but now we can call each other friends because Christ has called you friend. As I want to end with this, in the Gospel of John, chapter 15, verses 13 and 17, the only reason that we're able to gather here tonight is this: greater love has no one than this, than someone lay down his life for his friends. This is Jesus speaking to the disciples, speaking to you. You are my friends if you do what I command you to do, walking in truth. No longer do I call you servants, for the servant does not know what his master is doing, but I have called you friends. For all that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you, and I have appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should abide more than your name. So that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it to you. And these things I command you so that you will love one another. There's no greater joy than to walk in the truth, be conformed to the image of his Son, and be encouraged by the testimonies of faithful brothers and sisters to keep running the race, knowing that we have not attained, but we will one day, entering into the glory of Jesus Christ. Amen? Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for the testimonies that are shown here in Scripture. Testimonies that will last a lifetime, even into eternity. Father, we don't want to take any of these words lightly. We want to take them soberly. We want to take them in a manner that is real and tangible. Father, help us, Lord, if we have learned anything tonight, Lord Jesus, would you affect it to our hearts for lasting change, not just a temporary flippant idea that goes away in the morning. Lord God, I pray for us in our prayer lives, Lord Jesus. This church cannot survive unless this congregation is one that is built around prayer. Lord, would you conform us? Would you motivate us, encourage us to be men and women of prayer? Fathers who pray for their wives and their children. Mothers that pray for their husbands and their children, their church, their leaders, their city, their state, their country. Lord God, conform us in the way that you want us to be so that we might walk in truth, Lord Jesus. Help us, Lord God. We're so easily sinful people. We so easily go astray. We so easily wander. Father, as the Good Shepherd, gather us together as your flock. More than just what we do on Wednesday night, Sunday morning. But Lord, gather us together in a unity that cannot be understood in this world. Lord, we know that you can do it. We know that the Holy Spirit can do it. Arrange that in our lives so that we might truly be lovers of truth and proclaimers of truth in love. Help us, Lord Jesus. We cannot do it on our own. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that broadcast. I pray that the Word of God affected your life and will go forth from your head to your heart and begin to affect your family, affect your neighborhood, affect your workplace. We welcome you to join us on Sunday mornings at 8:30 and 10:30, but only if you're not attending a church elsewhere in this community. I welcome you also to consider how the Lord would use you with this word and in his spirit to do something eternal in these last days. God bless you. Once again, this is Paul Berry, Senior Pastor of Calvary Chapel.